All right, we're gonna go through several popular songs and say why they suck. The previous videos, I just did like one song for a long time, but these videos are like too annoying for that. So we're gonna have to go faster. Like this song, it's not just the lyrics are awful, the music is like extra awful and hard to listen to. It's hard to take. So this girl has issues. Issues are bad. I don't know if she like knows that. The beginning's boring. Oh wait, I went too far. When I'm down, I get real down. When I'm high, I don't come down. I get angry. Baby, believe me. I can love you just like that. Oh yeah, here we go. You just as fast. Okay, yeah. So she's jelly and emotional and up and down emotionally. And she gets angry. These are all like bad things. And she can like love him one moment and then leave him the next moment. That's bad. She's like unstable. Bad person she is and how she has problems. Why would someone want to listen to that? That's like weird. But the chorus gives you some clues. But you don't judge me, 'cause if you did, baby, I'd judge you too. Right, so she just hates judgment. You know, Ayn Rand had a motto of like, judge and prepare to be judged. I think that's in virtue of selfishness. But this bitch is like, you don't judge me and I don't judge you. We're all bad people. Everyone's bad. Just get over it that everyone's bad. Like, accept badness. We'll all be bad. No heroes, no Howard Roarks, no John Galtz. We'll just all be terrible people. We'll all be the shitty masses. Which is interesting coming from a celeb, like an elite. And to be like normal people. Store or whatever, when they're not. Like, that's not what their life is. It's fake. Good too. Because she admits she has issues. Well, first she repeats herself, that's boring. But we're almost to admitting she has issues. She explains it. Here we go. So they're both going to treat each other badly. She gives him her issues. I mean, she's like taking out her bitchiness on him. And he gives his issues to her, meaning he like acts badly around her. And then they just put up with each other. They're basking in the glory. They're calling it glory to have a bunch of problems. Like, that's total nonsense. They think that their problems are good and glorious. Like, that's, they don't understand what glory is. Their sense of life is so fucked up. Claim love solves problems? I think I've heard that one before. And I think it's incoherent and irrational. Yeah, and then she says one of her issues is needing him. So she's like emotional, but her love for him is part of her emotionalness. So that's also bad. Like, it actually shows that their love itself is rotten. It's like her anger and her issues, rather than it being some like pure romantic nice thing. She's just accepting being a shitty person with a shitty life and so on. I don't know. Horrible song. Shit like this, super popular. This has 181 million YouTube views. For singing that shit. Incoherent. You got hands like an ocean, push you out, pull you back in. Like, it's not like an ocean. That's not ocean-like. They just throw things in that don't make a lot of sense. They don't care. It's not a logic song. Listen, it like influences how they think. Like, because if they actually didn't like this, and if this was viewed negatively, if this like clashed with their sense of life, if people are like, what the fuck, that makes no sense, that's retarded, it wouldn't be so popular. So it's not like a primary cause of people having these views, but it helps reinforce them, it helps build them up, it helps reflect them and like show what the culture is like. Because millions of people actually see like appeal in this kind of singing and thinking. All right. One starts off really slow. This is Ariana Grande.
So I got pregnant so we can be pregnant at the same time.
This one's weird because people think that it's a fucking feminist song. It's not? We'll get to that at the end.
Just a rumor.
Anyway, it has these like weird teen movie kind of things.
Ariana Grande told me my hair looks sexy.
So I just wanted to go to the actual song. She's not wrong. Oh, we're like here. The beginning's boring though. She just like mentions people that she thought she'd be with. Anyway, so one taught her love, one taught her patience, and one taught her pain. Pain is a bad thing. That's not a good lesson. Like, what the fuck? This song is... Well, we're about to get there. Okay. Here we go. Say I've loved when I've lost. Okay, so her theme is people think she loved and she lost, so it's like bad that she had this series of breakups. But what she sees, her perspective, is it was good because she learned things from each of her relationships. In theory, that could be a good thing. That could make sense. That could be reasonable. Like, it would be good if you had a series of relationships from which you learned things. However, she's a fucking liar. Educational relationships, they're romances. They're not about learning things. Like, she learns tiny little things. Like, she learns how to be... She learns, like, which of her bitchy behavior alienates her exes the most. Like, she gets some examples and experiences about what people take badly and, like, what crap she can't get away with. But she's not, like, substantially learning. They're not teaching her. Like, they never go into teacher mode. If they were, like, giving her lectures, she'd be like, fuck off, thank you, next. And also, the thank you, next thing is, like... It's really, really condescending and rude and disrespectful. Sort of means, like, fuck off, but she's saying it in a dishonest, disingenuous, unclear way. It's, like, passive-aggressive. Also, I'm so fucking grateful for my ex. That's, like... She's, again, she's lying. Grateful. Like, she'd rather it had worked out. She's just a liar. Might be all I had to say about this one. That's enough of that one. Oh, wait, right. Oh, so people think it's feminist. So, like, here's an example article. Thank you, next music video is a celebration of all things female. If you thought God as a Woman was her most feminist anthem, wait until you watch the music video, Thank You, Next. So, this article is retarded. I didn't read it all. But just look at the pictures, and this is supposed to be feminist. Like, how is this picture right here feminism? Not feminism. That's like the opposite of feminism. No, it's here. This is the fucking opposite of feminism right here. This is not empowered women. This is women being dolls for men, like, according to the feminist perspective. Like, the real feminist perspective does not like this and thinks it's objectifying women. And now people are saying that this fucking song is feminist. Using feminism, like the actual ideas, with just pro-woman. See, the thing they like about the song, they call it like a girl power song, is it's saying the woman can have power and can say thank you next. Like, she can reject guys, she can be powerful, she can be sexy or alluring, wanted, she can be in a position of power. So it's supposed to be about like female power, but that's completely different from feminism. Feminism was actually, like, originally more of an intellectual movement about equality and about improving society and about cultural reform, and was not in favor of cheerleaders. It saw that as, like, oppression of women, where women were sort of brainwashed into wanting to be dolls for men. So it thought that was bad and that women could be, like, fucking scientists or something. And then Ariana comes around and says... Well, women are really pretty. That's a type of power. Look how pretty I am. And then people actually think that's feminism. So a lot of, like, feminists today, or people who think they're feminists, like, have no fucking clue what feminism is. That's an extra side note. All right, this is Taylor Swift, You Need to Calm Down. I think it's, like, a recent one. Yeah, premiered June 17, 2019. I just went on our channel, and this was the first one. You are somebody that I don't know, but you're taking shots at me like it's Patron, and I'm just like, damn, it's 7 a.m. Okay. So this song I thought was the most interesting one of all the ones that I'm going to go through. Because it has all this social status stuff. Most of them are just like relationships. Really, really, really bad advice about relationships. But this one is about how to present yourself as higher social status than other people. It also has a different theme, which is LGBT stuff. It's like a gay activism song. That's what it's supposed to be about. But she doesn't actually talk about that until like a ways in. Here, it's like this far down in the lyrics, it wasn't even visible, is where she overtly says, because shade never made anybody less gay, because being a hater didn't make people less gay. Like flaming them on Twitter or being hateful towards homosexuals did not make them stop being homosexual, which is actually an odd thing to say in several ways. But anyway, she doesn't actually get to that forever. What she does at the beginning is just self-promote. So you're somebody that I don't know, like you're low status, you're taking shots at me. That means you're reacting to me. You are coming to me. You care about me. I don't care about you. You care about me. So that is saying she's high status. She's putting in less effort. Her hater is putting in more effort. She's like the chill, aloof one. And people come to her and then react to her and care a lot about her. So she's presenting herself as higher status, as a person people react to. The like it's Patron, that is an alcohol reference. It doesn't even make sense. It's just like it's a pun because she said shots. So she means shots like insults, but also shots like how much she drinks when she parties. Because if she was partying and they were alcohol shots, she'd drink like so many. So she's saying you're taking shots like that, meaning you're like taking a lot of shots at me and like big shots and, you know, like enthusiastic shots. So she's reaffirming that she's a party girl because that's high status and people like parties. And you're supposed to like parties. And if you don't, you're weird and that would be low status. And then it's just like, damn, it's 7 a.m. So it's 7 a.m. means like, why are you up so early? Like that's saying you're try hard. Like, why would you even bother hating on someone at 7 a.m.? Don't you have better things to do, like sleeping in? Getting ready for work or whatever. It's low status to be flaming people online at 7 a.m. Like, it's extra low status. Like, if you do that at 7 p.m. in the evening after work and you're, like, tired and bored or whatever, you know, that's still bad, but it's not as bad. If you're doing it at 7 a.m., it's like, what the fuck is wrong with your life? It's like drinking in the morning. And, you know, the visuals have drinking in the morning. And she brought up Patron. So she's trying to imply that people who flame you on Twitter at 7 a.m. are like people who drink alcohol by themselves at home in their trailer at 7 a.m. putting down people, but she's doing it indirectly and she's pretending that the issue is there attacking her. And that I'm just like, damn, that means she like barely reacts. She barely notices. She doesn't argue back. She doesn't refute what they say. She's just like, you know, a bit surprised by how much of a loser the other person is. And that's her whole reaction, which is a very high status reaction. It's because she's barely reacting. She's just not that into them. It's sort of like saying, why are you so into me? I don't care about you. Whoever puts more effort into interactions and is more reactive is the lower status person. And all of these lines are playing into that. But they don't say that directly. You know, it's show, not tell. She doesn't say, why are you so reactive and you care about me more than I care about you? You're trying hard. You know, she's showing that they're try hard indirectly by telling a story. Being try hard is bad, which is, it's a very nasty worldview. Where, like, effort is considered a bad thing. But that is how social stuff works. The street, that's a knockout. But you say it in a tweet, that's a cop-out. And I'm just like, hey, are you okay? Oh, and the just like is important. Like, the word just. Her whole reaction. I'm just like, damn, it's 7 a.m. That means, like, just means only, like there was no more reaction than that. It's like you took like many shots, like it's Patron, like you know you flamed me like 10 times on Twitter and I was just like, damn, it's 7 a.m. and that was like the whole reaction. It's like you barely get a reaction after all that flaming. She's downplaying and minimizing her own reaction part. So the next one does the same thing again. Hey, I'm just like, hey, are you okay? Which is fucking condescending. Like, this one's condescending too. Like, you know, the person saying something that actually has a topic. Like, the person saying, I hate you because X, or I hate you because Y. And Taylor completely ignores that. She's just like, damn, it's 7 a.m. Why are you so angry? But she's not actually responding on the topic that the person probably made some sort of argument about. Like, a good argument, but, like, more than zero is typical. Like, even if you hate someone for being gay, you'll be like, you know, God hates fags. That's an argument. It's not a good one, but it's like, you know, you're anti-religious, you're anti-Christian, you don't respect American values. You know, there's, like, a theme there. And if you just say, damn, it's 7 a.m. to that, you're completely ignoring the actual point the person was making that you're anti-Christian. You know, you're not responding to what their point was. It's not a very good point, and one could respond to it. Like, you know, it's refutable, but Taylor isn't trying to refute it. If she doesn't actually say what the person's argument is, but, you know, if, even if you make up a bad one, she's still not trying to refute it. And like, hey, are you okay? That's just like, that just means your comments are so stupid that I think you have a problem. Then they're not even worth responding to. You're too low status to even be responded to. Your comments don't matter. You don't matter, but you seem to be like hurting to have trouble. So the thing going on here is like, you think you're flaming me, but you're just showing that you suck. Which this is all like, it's counter flame. Like, Taylor is being mean to the person who hates her. The haters, the flamers who like tweet things. But she's not admitting she's being a bitch. Like, when you say damn at 7 a.m., you're not admitting that you're saying fuck you too, buddy, or fuck you back, or whatever, same to you, you know, something like that. Like, that's what it means, but she won't admit it. When you say, hey, are you okay? That's extremely like rude and condescending and disrespectful, but it's not admitting it, it's passive aggressive. This part, say it in the street, that's a knockout, but you say it in a tweet, that's a cop-out. That's saying basically, if you had the balls to say that to someone's face, it would be like a good insult, it would be good flame, it'd be a good shot. You know, it'd actually be a good argument, which is interesting because it's conceding a lot. It's like you actually had a good comment to the hater. But then she says, but you say it in a tweet, that's a cop-out. So she's saying basically, you're not man enough to face me. But also she's saying basically, if you are not the kind of person who gets to see me in the street, you know, if you don't live in my neighborhood, you don't get to talk, you don't get to say shit, you never can talk to me. The internet is invalid. You have to be in my social circle to say anything to me. That's what she means here. Like, you're not part of my social circle, so you're not allowed to speak to me, so fuck off. Saying things online is a cop-out. It's like a pussy thing to do. Which is also, it's flaming the person, but she's not admitting that she's being a total bitch. And that's what a lot of social status stuff is about. It's about being mean to people while not admitting you're being mean. Whoever can pretend that they're not being mean and not putting in effort while actually doing high effort mean stuff is like the winner. So that's a stupid contest. And I ain't trying to mess with your self-expression, but I've learned a lesson that stressing and obsessing about somebody else is no fun. And snakes and stones never broke my bone, so... Okay, the snakes and stones is weird because the saying is sticks and stones. Like, is that actually a thing? Like, sticks and stones, 7 million. It could be regional or something, I don't know. Snakes and stones, 136,000. Right, so snakes and stones is not a thing. She's just using, like, a weird thing that's similar to a common thing. Oh, like, sticks and stones may break my bones. Like, sticks and stones can hurt me, but insults don't, is the actual saying. Stones may break my bones, but names will never harm me. So it's saying, like, I can take insults as long as you don't use physical violence. But this one says stones are not going to break her bones. So it's actually just, like, pretty incoherent. Anyway, she says, I ain't trying to mess with your self-expression. This is like when you say no offense, comma, and then you say something offensive. The reality of what you're doing. Like, you do something, but you also say you're not doing it. And you're just trying to force this framing on people. You're being, like, aggressively pushy about claiming reality is one way when it's clearly not. You're trying to force your view of reality on the other person. And it treats communication as like a contest for who gets to control the narrative. And neither person cares about like the actual facts or actual reality. They're just both trying to control a narrative. And her narrative is she's not being a bitch. She's not messing with the other person's self-expression. She's not doing anything wrong. She's not being aggressive. That's her narrative. So she's pretending she's not being aggressive. And she's a fucking liar. But That's what that means. So she says, I'm not trying to, you know, be offensive, be a bitch, etc. But, and then she does it. I've learned, so what does she actually say? I've learned the lesson that stressing and obsessing about somebody else is no fun. So she doesn't say you're wrong. She doesn't say what you're saying is false. She doesn't give counter arguments. She doesn't say, actually, I'm a very religious person. I find religion compatible with being homosexual or whatever. She says, I've learned the lesson. So she's appealing to life experience. She says, I'm more worldly than you. I know about the world better. I have more wisdom, more streetwise, more book learning, everything. I've dealt with people before, unlike you. You're a newbie. And so what I've learned is stressing and obsessing about somebody else is no fun. In other words, you're not having fun. You're not a fun person. You're not the life of the party. Because you stress and obsess. You're too try hard. You're too reactive. You care about other people. You should care about yourself. And you know, she says that because she's talking about the other person. Like, she's talking to the person. She's telling this other guy, I've learned this lesson. And then she's commenting on their behavior. And her comment is, you shouldn't care about other people. But she's saying that to another person. So she's a hypocrite. The visuals are also relevant. Like, she's chilling in a pool. Like, you're not getting to me. I'm chill. I'm doing my own thing. You don't matter. That is the meaning of this visual. Like, you're not affecting her. She has her own life. You're not even there. You know, she's relaxing in the pool and you're like angry on the internet. So she's again higher status than you. She has better things to do. Sitting in a pool is apparently supposed to be a better thing, like a good thing to do. Wearing high heels while in the pool. A little odd, but fashion everywhere. That's one of their mottos. It's fake too. Like, look at that jacket thing she's wearing, the coat. Like, I strongly suspect the bottom of that might be touching the water and getting wet. Like, this is an inner tube. Like, her butt is in the water, I think. So I think the bottom of that coat is getting wet. It's probably actually, like, uncomfortable and impractical, you know? Like, not actually a good way to be in the pool. But they fake a lot of things for videos. It's like those people, there are models who pose on beaches, like, in the fucking winter, in swimsuits, and they're freezing their asses off, and they're smiling and doing a swimsuit photo shoot. That is a total real thing you can look up. Just pretend that it's summer when it is, in fact, winter. So she's telling the person, calm down, like, don't be so try hard, don't be so effortful, just relax and chill and have people come to you and be high status. It's all status. You're being too loud. Again, same thing, too much energy, you're too try hard. I'm just like, so she's only doing the one thing. For the third time, she's only having one reaction because she's so non-reactive. And her reaction is totally substantial. Her reaction is entirely about social dynamics, not the content of what the person said. She's not responding. She's not explaining why being homosexual is good or whatever. She's just like, you need to just stop. You need to calm down. Like, she's telling the person what to do. She's being a bossy bitch. And she's pretending she's the non-reactive one. Can you just not step on my gown? She said, can you just not? And she, like, pauses there, and then the step on my gown comes second. There's, like, a bit of a pause because can you just not is a rude, condescending thing you say to people. Like, can you just not? You don't even identify what the thing they need to stop doing is. It's just like, you know, what you're doing, don't do that. You're bad. You shouldn't do the things you do. It's like extra rude, and it puts so little effort into telling her what not to do or explaining why. Like, it's so far from giving a reason. Not step on my gown is like a metaphor. It means you're like a person who steps on someone's gown. Stepping on someone's gown literally is a bad thing. So it's a veiled reference to drag queens. And it's just trying to say you're doing something bad, but it's not a real reason because it's a metaphor. So again, you're someone we don't know. You're not part of our social circle. You're coming at my friends. So you're doing a social faux pas. You're being like aggressive and you're attacking your friends and you shouldn't be doing that. Why are you mad? Couldn't you just be happy? Social status. And then at some point it becomes about homosexuality. There are already visuals related to like homosexuality stuff, like the rainbow fence. And the gown was like a hint a bit, but not very much. Maybe glad with two A's means something. Glad rewrites the script for LGBTQ acceptance. Glad stand for. I really just want to know what it stands for, and I'm probably going to have to go to Wikipedia. What I find with a lot of like companies is their website doesn't even fucking tell you what they do. You just have to go to Wikipedia to get like summary info. Formerly the Gay and Lesbian Alliance Against Defamation. Okay, so that's what it stands for. See, Wikipedia tells you right away, but the actual organization doesn't tell you what their name means. So she accuses haters of homosexuals of being in the Dark Ages and like having... She says like they're making a sign. Making signs is try hard, but she's completely ignoring like Pride Parade. She fucking mentioned Pride Parades. You know, the pro-gay people make signs. But the anti-gay people must have taken all night on their song, and that's high effort and try hard, and that's bad. But the pro-gay people have the parade, and they have signs, and that's all, like, positive. And not too try hard, but the people who are haters and put in effort to signs, that's bad. It's completely hypocritical, double standards, make no sense. But she's just insulting people for effort. Like, you made a sign, it must have taken all night. You shouldn't spend all night doing things. It's not... You know, that's not a reason that the sign is bad. If you take all night doing something good, like writing a pop song, you know, she'd be in favor of that. She'd be like, oh, cool, you've put energy into something. You know, she'd see it positively. But very limited exceptions when people see effort positively. And in general, they see it negatively. A lot of what they see about being rich is you get to like lounge in the pool and they're like, cool, once you're rich, you can stop trying hard and relax because work sucks. Right. And she gets to, you need to take several seats. That's like sit down. Again, it's just being condescending and it's social dynamics. It's not actually about the content of what's being said. She's calling the other person like not peaceful and a screamer and a hater. And then, okay, so because shade never made anybody less gay. That means shade means insults. And she's saying basically flaming people won't make them stop being gay. The semi-implication is you're going about converting people to being straight in the wrong way. You should use reasoned arguments instead of shade, which is, you know, not at all a message she would agree with or actually mean. Because she doesn't think you should give reasoned arguments for not being gay. You know, she thinks you should accept being gay. So she's sort of saying it's not working, use a different method, but she doesn't actually want them to use a different method, and she wouldn't like that. And in fact, a lot of them do use a different method, and then what does she do? She calls them screaming haters. Like, a lot of them are not screaming haters, and they give semi-reasoned arguments that are not just, like, 7 a.m. tweet storm anger. Not engaging in the debate at all. And she's, instead of engaging in the debate and contributing some actual, like, ideas and persuasion, she's just ridiculing them and conflating them with the most angry, hateful people. Like, she won't acknowledge the, like, moderate homophobes. You know what I mean? She doesn't want to acknowledge the, like, the reasonable people who have some sort of issue with being gay, but, like, they're generally a reasonable person instead of just a hater. You know, there are a lot of Christians who do not like homosexuality, but they are not flaming gays with the retarded purpose of trying to make them less gay by being hateful towards them. Like, they don't actually expect that to work, and they're not trying to do that. Doesn't acknowledge their existence and just lumps everyone who has any issue with any of the visuals in the entire video, like this dancing guy and this drag queen, all this shit. If you have any issue with any of that, if you see any of that as negative in any way, then you are a hater who gets up at 7 a.m. to tweet people who are out of your league. So it's all nasty. And she brings up the internet here as well. We see over there on the internet comparing all the girls who are killing it. You need to calm down. So, awful song, all about social dynamics. Which is a nice break from the 90% of songs that are about relationships. Rough estimate. Okay, now here is a song that's about relationships. This is an old one, but it was popular back whenever it came out, I think. In 1999, it won awards. It reached number 3 in Canada and did well in the US, reaching number 1 on Billboard's Adult Top 40 and number 14 on the Hot 100. And it peaked at number 30 in the UK. And top 10 in Australia and New Zealand. So, yes, that's quite a successful song. And despite coming out in 1999 and being put on YouTube 10 years after release, it has accumulated 33.7 million views. Look, there's a girl. She's black, flesh and bone, no touch of silicone. Oh, he's anti-technology. So, she's like a real natural girl, so that's higher status. Artificial people are lower status. You know, science and medicine, bad. Just being perfect with no effort, good. Technology is effort, and we shouldn't need effort to be pretty. She's touch, smell, sight, taste, and sound. But somehow I can't believe that anything should happen. I know where I belong, and nothing's gonna happen. Okay, so he knows where he belongs, nothing's gonna happen. Like, the song is called She's So High, which means, because she's so high, high above me. She's lovely, high, like, she's like Cleopatra, Joan of Arc, Aphrodite. Those are like high status women who are out of the league. So the entire song, the whole meaning is, there's a girl, she's out of my league, and nothing's gonna happen with her. I can't believe anything would happen with her. Like, I can't even imagine it. It's unbelievable that I could get anywhere with a girl who's so out of my league. Which is a terrible message. It's teaching guys to be like scared of women, not confident, low self-esteem. Teaching them to put women on a pedestal. And who are guys actually looking at? In general, most guys primarily look at other women in their social circle. In other words, women who are not out of their league. A huge cultural movement in our society where women in the same social circle as a guy present themselves as out of his league, and a lot of people, male and female, think she's out of his league. And then if they get married, people say she's too good for him, or like, wow, how did he pull that off, or stuff like that. There's TV shows that do that. They make fun of Leonard on Bang Theory all the time when he's married to Penny, and they make jokes about like, you know, how did he get away with that? She's so better than him. She's higher status. He's so lucky. He's a loser, etc. It's very well, but I think there was some of that with the Monica Chandler relationship, probably. But I could be mistaken. Just put women from your social circle on a pedestal. This is not saying, like, put actresses on a pedestal. People already know actresses are out of their league. The primary way they're going to interpret this is, like, the girl in their class at school who they really like, but she's really pretty, they're like scared of her and think she's unbelievable. Society, she's got the best of everything. What could a guy like me ever really offer? She's perfect. Why should I even bother? So it's just like, give up. I'm worthless. She's amazing. And this is totally unrealistic. Like, most guys earn more money than most women. True. The statistics have been shifting. Because like women get more college degrees than men now, and they're more like conformist, and they do a little better on average in workplaces where social dynamics and office politics are important, as well as all the diversity hires and intentional promotion of women. That's like a major agenda as well. But there are a lot of jobs where women have the advantage now. But a lot of men get higher pay by doing less desirable jobs. Like, they put more effort into their career. They're willing to do jobs that are more dangerous or more rough or hard or, you know, some sort of downside, like working on an oil rig or working in a coal mine. A lot of women don't want to do that. Less a desirable job, that raises the pay. And men are the ones who are more willing to, like, go on an adventure in order to get a bunch of wealth so that they can get a woman, because they think the women are so high above them. Anyway, she calls to speak to me. I freeze immediately. Like, she wasn't out of his league. She's interested in him. She called him. But he freezes anyways because it feels unreal to him. That's a bad attitude. That's getting in the way of his success with women. It's not helping him. It's not realism that keeps him from trying to ask out actresses. Just fucking with his interactions with girls in his own social circle. There are a lot of pretty women. You shouldn't be, like, so, so impressed with them just because they learned how to put on makeup. And they're, like, the 80% of women who have pretty bodies and faces and whatever. Like, most women can be pretty attractive with enough effort. We've got Taylor.
You're on the phone with your girlfriend. She's upset. She's going off about something that you said. 'Cause she doesn't get your humor like I do.
The nice girl next door. The previous song was a nice guy song, like he's a beta male, kind of like the Sucker song, pretty similar to Sucker, which I did in a previous video. Is like genders reversed. She's the nice girl who has trouble asserting herself and having romantic success. However, she does have some self-confidence because she's at least singing like, I'm good. In some ways, I hope you realize it. Whereas this guy was like, I'm kind of worthless, I give up. Having trouble asserting themselves romantically and like actually getting with the people they want to be with. Anyway, so she says, like, you know, she's watching this guy she likes and he's dating someone else. And she sees it's not working very well. And she's saying she'd be a better fit. She would work better for him. Oh god, so this is like a common thing. People judge each other by music taste. Like, they actually do that. It seems fucking ridiculous and sort of like impossible, but it's totally a real thing. And that is why it is actually directly said in the lyrics. Like, she's bragging that she likes a different type of music than the girlfriend does. She gets his humor, and she likes different music than the girl. And also, she knows him better. She understands him better. And now we get the butt. What's good about her?
She wears short skirts, I wear t-shirts. She's cheer captain and I'm on the bleachers.
So, the girl is just lamenting that the other girl puts more effort into sexual clothing and activities and stuff. So she tries harder sexually and the guy likes that, and she's like, but I'm good in all the other ways. Why do you like someone who is sexually attractive? That's so unreasonable. You should be with me. And he's like, I'm not getting married yet. I want to be with someone attractive and maybe I'll consider you later. But see, a lot of these girls, they would be happy to be like pretty and popular. They would like that. They just don't know how. They're bad at it and they're bad at learning things. And like once you get behind, it's sort of hard to change roles in a society, in a community, like in a school class where like people know you and they know what your reputation is and what kind of person you are. It's hard to make a big change. People will notice and they'll look for like errors. They'll be like, you know, you're not really one of the popular pretty people. You're just faking. Because you weren't that last year. So they'll look for mistakes you make, like wear the wrong clothes or whatever. And they'll be harsher on you than the people who already have that established reputation. Like, you have to do it more perfectly than the cool kids, or they won't let you change stereotypes. skill and is partly higher standards for changes than for being something in the first place. So there's a lot of like jealousy, but she doesn't present the jealousy honestly. Saying she's downplaying the stuff she's worse at and she's upplaying the stuff she's better at. And a lot of people hear that and they like it because they too want to view their strengths as important and their weaknesses as not important. That's a very appealing message to a lot of people. It's also, by the way, very unrealistic in that she's very pretty in the video and she's wearing makeup and, you know, she has a stylist and a costume person and, like, they're sort of trying to present her as the girl next door, except they also keep her really pretty, which is an interesting dishonesty. There are other things that do a more of a contrast. Like, we'll get to her hot version. And you'll see that they look sort of similar. I'm just gonna skip ahead. There we go. See? Like, there's no glaring fucking difference about who's prettier. Like, this, she's the blonde. Yeah, they put glasses on her, but, and her hair's not as straight. But, like, she, look how much eye makeup she has on. She's got, like, lash extensions or whatever, and, like, a ton of mascara. And she's wearing lipstick, and she has plenty of, like, foundation and blush and whatever it is you put on your cheeks so your skin looks super smooth. Like, she's doing a lot of the hot girl stuff that's quite similar. Like, okay, this one has, like, a bit redder, pinker, purpler makeup. And, like, a bit more on her eyes, and, yeah, her hair is straighter and a bit longer, I guess. But it's not, like, as big of a difference as you sometimes see. This is a common theme where they do, like, makeovers and, you know, they compare the before and after. So you got, like, this movie. Here's, like, the not pretty one and then the pretty one. Like, they have more of a contrast. You can see a bigger difference between her two looks. Like, she's not ugly before at all. But they at least change her appearance to a larger degree, I think. Like, it just stands out a bit more. Anyways, I was also... See, there's this song... Okay, this is the girlfriend. And then this is the hot one. There's a strong contrast. Like, it's partly just like different color clothing and different hair color, but they're trying to make them like stand out as different. And they present them with like behavioral stuff too as very different. But this one, it's like she could fucking be a cheerleader. Like, you can look like that and be a cheerleader, that's fine. It fits. So we see, like, cheerleader, you know? But the other look is fine for cheerleader. So I find that weird. Not very important. It's just dishonest. Back to the actual song. It is about... No one who understands you. Been here all along, so why can't you see? So she's just sort of lamenting that the guy... She's totally into the guy. She's like, you're a great guy, but why do you not see this one thing? She doesn't blame it as like, he's blind, he's into stupid girls, that shows he lacks character or something, you know? She's not blaming him. She just treats it as totally natural. That a great guy that she totally wants is into a different type of person than her. She understands him, but he's into the hot girl, the cheerleader, anyways. Complaining about it. She's not offering solutions, and it's just a lot of women would like to see their situation that way because it's flattering. The problem is, she's great, but the guy doesn't see it, so he's making this one mistake. That's all that's going on. And she sort of explains it as like, oh, well, she's a cheerleader, so guys like that. It's understandable, but also he's wrong. And there's no real, like, logic to it. She's just asserting these things. And this is Shawn Mendes, Treat You Better. I should have fast-forwarded. I don't know when it starts. I, like, keep thinking it's about to start, so I don't fast-forward. Oh, fighting. Well, that's bad. All right, let's go. Won't lie to you. Oh, here we go. I know he's just not right for you. Okay, well, so this is a fucking lie. He won't lie to her. He lies to her later in the song. But also, when people say, like, I won't lie to you, it's a reasonable statement. It's not a serious kind of thing to say. It has no substance. It's not, here's my plan for how to avoid lying to you. It's not, here's, like, the books I read on honesty. It's not, here's why I think lying is bad. You know, I wrote a fucking essay on this. I won't lie to you. It'll be because I understand how lying works. I wrote an essay about it and about how people communicate implications and not all lies are overt. And you can lie when you don't realize you're lying. And actually, a lot of lies do not have conscious intention. And also, sometimes lying is actually okay. So I'm not going to say I would never lie to you no matter what, because that would be bad. Anyways, so like, if you actually understand things about lying, it's more plausible that you would be in a position to know whether or not you will lie in the future, to control your lying or that kind of thing. Talk about this. He doesn't know any of the stuff in the essay. He couldn't write this essay. So he doesn't know about lying. He doesn't have knowledge of lying. It's just, he's just saying it. It's just, he's a bullshit artist. What will he not lie about? He doesn't actually mean everything in general. He means the next thing he says. That guy's not right for you. You should be with me, not him. I won't lie to you. Choose me, don't choose him. It's so fucking, like, biased and self-centered. It's just sort of saying, like, I'm not biased, but I'm better than him, and you should choose me, not him. And you could tell me... It's not the kind of thing you say if you're actually an honest person. Like, an honest person says, I'm doing my best to be unbiased. It's hard, but here's a few things I took into account. I'll show you my reasoning so you can judge for yourself if I did a good analysis or if bias got the better of me. But he doesn't do that at all. If I'm off, but I see it on your face when you say that he's the one that you... Oh, he does say you can tell me if I'm off, but that's not like an intellectual comment. It's actually sort of a challenge. He's sort of like saying, if you can't point out how I'm off, then that proves I'm right. He's sort of permissioning himself to say things by pretending he's open to criticism, but he's not really open to criticism. He's saying, I see it on your face. Like, that's not a thing that he's actually expecting, like, pushback on. What you want, and you're spending all your time in this wrong situation, and anytime you want it to stop. Tell her, in part, is that she already knows that she wants him and not her current boyfriend. So she says one thing, but he sees in her face that she doesn't mean it. So he's basically saying she's lying to herself. But he wouldn't put it that way, but that's kind of what he's saying is, I can see that you're lying to yourself. You say that, but you clearly don't really believe it. You're clearly in a wrong situation, and whenever you accept that it's not working and you need to give up and move on, then... he's totally ready to step in and fuck her because he's such a white knight. I know I can treat. That was sarcasm. You better than he can. And any girl like you deserves a gentleman. He knows he can treat her better than the other guy. Like, how the fuck does he know that? Does he, like, stalk them and, like, watch how the guy treats her? Does he, like, know what the guy is like in private? Because a lot of people act a bit different with a girl in private than they do in their public persona. Gentleman, which is totally him and not the other guy, because he says so. He's such a gentleman that he's accusing her of wasting time, and he sees on her face that she's a fucking liar. And that she makes bad decisions. Tell me, why are we wasting time on all your wasted crime when you should be with me? So he's calling her relationship. It said on your wasted crime, but it says crying in the lyric. Be wasting time on all your wasted crime when you should be with. It sounded a lot like crime. It was hard to hear though. It could have been crying. Tell me, why are we wasting time on all your wasted crime when you should be with. For the deciding vote, we'll need other lyric sites. Yes. Alright, next one. Lyrics in the search. That'll work better. Okay, lyrics.com. Wasted Crying. With the G omitted. And then we have Metro Lyrics. All right. It is decided. He said crying. I was going to comment on the crime thing. Because it's like, if you're calling her relationship with the other guy a crime, you're not being a gentleman. But, okay, it's wasted crying. So, he's accusing her of wasting time and wasting crying. So, basically, he's saying that following her own judgment and making her own choice is a waste. Like, it wasn't worth a try. It's just, like, bad and she shouldn't even be doing it. She should just immediately be with him. Because he knows he can treat her better. Not because of any objective evidence that he can treat her better. He just knows it. He says, I know it, so you should act on his knowledge. He's claiming it, so just believe him. He won't lie. He said so. If someone says they won't lie and they say they know something, then it must be true. Especially when her judgment is so bad, she's like a liar who shows it on her face. And also the other guy, who probably also said he won't lie to her, and then contradicted this guy, he's not a gentleman. So just ignore what he said. Like, there's no fucking logic to this. It's all just assertions. Just see things my way. I just want to claim whatever I want that's good for me and fuck the other people. With me is dead. I know I can't, then he can. Can you say stop? Oh yeah, this. I stop time for you. It's just, like, lying. That I think was the lie I remembered. Like, you can't stop time for her. That's not true. You're lying. I mean, he'll say he's exaggerating, it's a metaphor, but, like, even if you take a metaphorical meaning, what the fuck does it mean that's true? Pushing her, he's saying stop wasting this time. So apparently he doesn't have, like, this control over time, and the time, it's time sensitive, time matters. Then he stops time for you. The second you say you'd like me to, I just want to give you the loving that you're missing. How is that stopping time? That's just reacting promptly. I will put on hold other things in my life when you are willing to fuck me. Stopping time because he's stopping, like, the other things because he'll have time for her right away. Like, that almost sort of makes a little bit of sense, but not really, and it was just, like, a wild guess. Up with her. See, I told you, he wants to fuck her. He's gonna call her baby and wake up in a bed with her. That's what his plan is. Everything he needs. Like, do you think that doesn't include sex? That's totally sex. He needs sex with her. Tell me what you want to do. What he wants. He's telling her, you know, date me, fuck me, and then I'll be happy, and I know it'll be great for you too. Just tell me what you want. But he doesn't want to hear what she wants. She said what she wants. She said, you say that he's the one that you want. She wants boy too. And boy one is like, oh no, I see it on your face. Then he's like, tell me what you want, but he doesn't fucking listen to her. Anyways, why does this shit resonate with people? Because they feel like they're in this situation where they know they could treat some girl better than her current boyfriend, and they totally want her, and they think it would work out great. Of course, their history of relationships working out great is like 0 for 5 or whatever, sometimes 0 for 0, and you wonder how they know they'd do so well. There's a lack of integrity there. But yeah, I think it's for people who are just like super into this girl. Oh, and they have one-itis. Like, they're really into a particular girl. They're not just like, oh, I want a girl. They're like, I want that girl. I like that one. I looked at her. She was pretty. I thought it would work. I made up a personality for her that's different than the words that come out of her mouth. And I'm pretty sure it's the real her because I saw her face. And I could just read her face better than her words. So I ignored her words. Anyways, so this is all terrible. And again, popular. This one, in fact, 1,767,000,000 views. This is the most popular song out of these. Ariana Grande is only like 400 million. This one's like 4 times more popular than that. More than 4 times more popular in terms of YouTube views. That is like really a lot of views. When does she sing? Oh, that's a lot of eye makeup. Right, Maybe it's not so much makeup, but that's like a lot of added lashes. Like, that's not what people's eyes actually look like. It's like really heavy artificial. Compared to that song, like, well, she's blood, flesh, and bone. She is blood, flesh, and bone. No tucks or silicone. See, these fake eyelashes are not tucks, and they're not made out of silicone. I'm pretty sure they're not silicone. I don't know what they're made out of, but it's probably not silicone, right? Some other type of plastic? So she's totally a real girl. Totally counts. That's like natural beauty right there. That's sarcasm. Engage strictly intellectually with these things because they are about social dynamics, and like poking fun at them and using like mild amounts of social dynamics on them like diffuses them and shows how they're vulnerable to their own game. It's like you can beat them intellectually, but they're not playing the intellectual game. So showing that you can beat them at their own game, at the rules that they play by, I think also is meaningful. Like, I don't like sarcasm in general because I think it's both mean and unclear. But I think that these songs are extremely mean, and like, it's good to diffuse them. I think that's okay to do. And it's not being mean to like a particular person who's going to get offended. Like, Taylor can take it. She's put herself out there as a public figure who is spreading ideas, and she's super fucking popular and rich. She'll be fine. And people say a lot ruder things about her already, so I'm not too worried about like hurting her. And as far as clarity, that's why I keep saying that was sarcasm. Like, literally, a lot of people think that there's jokes and sarcasm and whatever are obvious. And it's like, sure, probably 80% of the time your friends know what you meant, maybe more. But there's other people who are like from different subcultures than you. They're younger or older than you. They grew up in a different place than you. They live in a different country. Like, stuff that seems obvious to you may not be obvious to them. People have a hard enough time understanding you when you're like, just say what you mean. So when you say like the opposite of what you mean, you can confuse people. So I think mentioning stuff with sarcasm is helpful to some people.
You were in college working part-time, waiting tables, left a small town, never looked back. I was a flight risk with the fear of falling, wondering why we bother with love if it never lasts.
Okay, so the fear of falling is a metaphor for falling in love, I think. So she's a flight risk, meaning she like leaves relationships because she's wondering why we bother with love if it never lasts. Like, so she's had multiple failed relationships. She like runs from them. She's scared of falling in love. Fine with a guy who just like waits tables part-time. So she's the girl next door who's in your social circle and not above you. There's a bunch of guy songs that sing about how girls are way above them, like this and Sucker. But a fair amount of girls are like, you know, happy to find a guy. They're not trying to like scare all the guys off. They actually want a guy who's confident enough to like come up to them and ask them out and whatever. They're not saying like, never ask anyone out, you're not good enough. So she's like, you're part-time waiting tables, but that's fine. You left a small town and didn't look back. That's a good thing. That's praise. Wanted to make something of himself. And, you know, waiting tables is temporary. He's in college. He'll get a real job later. Work your way up. That's what she's saying. So it's okay. She accepts that. She understands that. She's not looking down on him. That's nice. She's being nice. And she talks about her own problems, but it's not like that Issues song where you know, we both have issues. We're both awful people. This is just, you know, she has some problems. She's not saying accept all the problems. She's actually trying to get over them. Like, in the song, she will get over it. Like, you know, she marries him or whatever. See, there's like family pictures. So she was a flight risk, but she gets over it. She improves. So this is it's a nicer song than some of the other ones, I think. I think this is one of her older songs, and it's like more country music than pop music. And country music is more like wholesome and in favor of reasonable American values in general. Like, it's still often quite bad and has very negative parts, and we'll get to some. But there's more to like about it. Like, it's not just pure awful. Like, some of these songs are just like everything this song is saying is horrible. And the fact that anyone likes this is disturbing. Whereas this one is not as bad. I don't remember all the rest of it, so maybe it gets like really bad later, I forget. But, you know, the start is, most of them were like much worse, like one paragraph in. including some by Taylor. Like, it's not just about the person. I did two Taylor songs that were awful. This one wasn't super awful, but it was bad. And then this one was super awful. This was pure social shit, as well as gay activism with no intellectual content. And it's an intellectual issue, and it should be treated as an intellectual issue where, like, it's a debate and ideas matter. It should not be treated as, like, ridicule and attack the other side and delegitimize the other side. It's really nasty to take people who disagree with you and then delegitimize them and say you can't be like that. That just makes you a bad person. You should treat it as, like, you're intellectually mistaken. You thought about it the wrong way. You know, you didn't understand all the logic, but, you know, if you read a few books, you can get educated and see why you're wrong. And, you know, things can be explained to you and you can learn better. She's not treating it as, like, a learning issue. She's treating it in a different way. So that's really nasty, I think. This is just, like, pro-romance, like, can you believe it? It's sort of like romance is a dream come true that's hard to believe. That's bad. It's not, like, the worst. It's not about people, like, hurting each other. Like, a lot of the relationship songs are about how much they hurt each other and fight and shit. I think this one actually has a fight. But this particular part is, like, positive, at least. She's like, it's hard to believe that we're so happy, you know, it's positive. That, like, the thing worked out. You put your arm around me. Wait, he has a tattoo. See, she's trying to look very young, innocent, virginal. The headband thing, it's signaling, like, young virgin. If not, like, an actual virgin, still, like, the same type of person, like, in that category. The tattoo does not fit that theming. I wasn't expecting the guy in the video to have a tattoo. Like, especially not a visible tattoo. That's, like, a bit rough. Like, his appearance other than the tattoo doesn't look like very bad boy. It's just the tattoo doesn't quite fit. Because he's, like, a husband role. You know, she's not just dating him because she likes sex. That's not one of those songs. She's getting married because she likes marriage. And tattoos don't fit that theme. Neither does the amount of makeup she's wearing. For the first time, you meet a rebel of a careless man's but like, okay, look for at that. Just the body language of this guy, like jumping around at the beach. What he's doing. That's not manly. He's not being a manly man. He's being like a young, nice guy. Which is fine. It just doesn't fit the tattoo. Like, he's not acting like a stereotypical person who has a tattoo on their arm. Like, you don't expect tattoo to jump around like, we'll watch one more time. This. That's not dignified. It's not tattoo-y. It's not like a biker guy. Like, tattoos are not, you don't have to be a biker, but they're a little more in that direction. You know, they're associated with stuff like prison or hard labor. Like, working part-time waiting tables while attending college is not tattoo central. Like, it's possible to do that and have a tattoo, but it's not a strong association. And usually these sorts of songs are very idealized. Like, they pick the perfect actors and the perfect costumes and the perfect scenery to really focus on their theme. They don't want anything to detract for the theme. So it's like, it's perfectly possible for that guy to have a tattoo in real life, but they usually avoid anti-thematic elements that are, like, you know, within realism, but not the most thematic. Like, they usually optimize more than that. Okay, I'm not sure why her father is careless. Like, what's the point of that? So she's careful for some reason. The father's careless. So, like, again, this is not a tattoo scene. Like, look, he's lying with his head in her lap. That's, like, nice. That's sweet. It's not, I have a tattoo. It's not a bad boy thing. Water, he put her arm around her. So it's, like, kind of thing less offensive than let's, like, party and have sex the first night we meet. I think that it's a better way of life overall on average. I think it's an unrealistic fantasy. Like, this is the kind of thing Godwin criticized, where people don't know each other that well and they make up this fantasy about each other and they get married without really knowing each other that well. And they, like, this song is playing into that fantasy. Like, you meet a guy, he seems nice, and you imagine a family and you imagine it's going to work out. I'm trying to encourage people to do that, and that's dangerous because it frequently does not work out the way they imagined. They underestimate how complex people are. They underestimate the complexity of the human condition. They underestimate how different people are. Like, people have so many different parts to them that so many parts don't match. They find a bunch of stuff that does match, and that's partly because they put their best foot forward. They try to be agreeable, nice, friendly, positive. They try to show aspects of themselves that the other person will like. And they can only keep that up so long to such an extent. Like, they always do that in their marriage to some extent, but they do it to a lesser extent. Like, they can't maintain the act so strongly all the time forever. It's a careless man. So a rebel, he made a rebel out of a careful daughter. I'm not sure why she's a rebel either. Like, getting married is not rebellious. So that's odd. Also, it's putting a lot of the initiative on him. Like, we were sitting there, you put your arm around, like, he took the initiative, you made a rebel, he made her into a rebel, like, he's shaping and forming her. In possession over him, but she is the one who is more passive, and is, things are being done to her. People as possessions, that's another thing that's bad. Anti-independence, and it's anti-autonomy. It's anti- merging the people together. Well, so it's fucking with the tradition of private property. Like, private property is a good tradition. We actually, when you say someone's mine, to some extent what you mean is we're sharing things. Like, it's mine refers to the private property tradition. And that tradition is good. Like, it's good to have possessions. It's good to own things. It's good to have control over things that are yours. So people like that. They like owning things. They like their phone being theirs. They don't have to share their phone with anyone. When they say that that person is theirs, what do they mean? Like, partly they mean, I'm not sharing this guy with any other women. You know, this is not a polygamous relationship. So there's something positive about that. But they also mean, to some extent, that we're sharing our lives together. We're merging our lives. So they actually have, like, less private property. They share a house. They share a lot of their possessions. They have less independence. So referring to the private property tradition to praise a marriage arrangement where they have less private property, where they have joint property, is, like, weird. Like, if you think it's good that to have things that are yours, and then you get married and you share a lot of property, like, you should see that as a downside. But they somehow also see that as a positive, like, because it's part of marriage and they're pro-marriage. Taking on the world together, that's a fantasy. That's not realistic. I mean, it's partly realistic. Like, people manage that to some extent, but these kinds of songs romanticize it and really exaggerate how well it works. So it's like, if you get married, you can have someone to take on challenges with you. Like, to some extent, that's a real thing. You can have that. Not with all spouses, but with some spouses, like the reasonable ones who are more into this type of song that's, like, more wholesome than partying. Because the ones who are, like, really into partying are not really into taking on the world together. Like, you know, hopefully it's a phase, but good luck. At least something positive, but I think they, like, massively exaggerate it and fool people about how well it works. And people, like, rush into it way too blindly with, like, not enough critical thinking, not enough awareness of the risks. And one of the things that happens, by the way, is to some extent this stuff worked better in the past when more women had this kind of attitude to life, more men as well, and this kind of expectation about how life works. I don't think it ever worked great, but it was when society is more homogeneous and everyone has the same views on marriage to some extent, you can just marry a random woman without being any better at getting to know them, probably worse at it because they had, like, more limited contact between the sexes back then. They were more, like, chaperoned. But anyways, you can marry, like, a random person and there's a good chance they'll be pretty normal. And as society has gotten more diverse, you get wives who do not do the wife role or husbands who do not do the husband role well. And that gets, like, a bit more common, that people are more varied. What this song encourages and what happens a lot is guys marry party girls and they expect to take on the world together. They expect the girl to be like this kind of girl when she's a different kind of girl. They just expect her to be both, because there's all this shit about like we're empowered and women can be everything and do everything, and they don't see anything as like contradictory or separate. Like partying's normal and taking on the world together in a marriage is normal, so we'll just have both. And I think that often doesn't work out. And with a person who has this kind of attitude, who's like a more wholesome person, it frequently works out much less well than they expect it to. But with someone who's like not even actively this kind of person, it's like extra, extra dangerous. I think a lot of people just aren't looking at it critically and are not aware enough of the danger, and they're not being careful enough.
Flash forward and we're taking on the world together. And there's a drawer of my things at your place.
Oh, this song is so old it doesn't have like closed captions? Wait. Annotations are on. Right, so the song is like old enough that they didn't even put the lyrics into the video.
You learn my secrets and you figure out why I'm guarded. You say we'll never make my parents' mistakes.
They're moving into a place together. It's different than a party song, but it's adequately express the risks of what they're doing. And stuff like this, we got nothing figured out. Like, that's bad. We have bills to pay and we haven't figured it out. That is a bad thing. And they're treating it as, like, normal. Like, we're young and, you know, it's expected that we don't have everything figured out. And you, like, take a leap of faith and you make it work out. And I think that is dangerous. Like, you can plan more than that. Active tradition where guys say, you know, I can't marry you yet. I have to, like, have a stable income that can support a family. You have to wait longer for marriage until I'm ready, like my career is far enough along. Whereas this is just like marry him while he's in college waiting tables and hopefully he'll get a career later. And he's not like taking responsibility for actually having enough money before they get a home together and move in and get her pregnant. And okay, look how much he's smiling while unloading luggage and packages. That's like glorifying something that's actually manual labor. Like, I know that the situation is nice, but you're not, it's not realistic to really be smiling that much while you're like unloading shit and just doing work. Like, that's work. That's not actually that fun. It's like, yes, you're looking forward to certain parts of it. You want the result, but overly exaggerating how like nice it is instead of being like, okay, well, that part, like the unloading, is actually just kind of annoying and you'd rather pay someone to do it for you but you don't have enough money.
We got nothing figured out when it was
well, paying people to unload your stuff is like, it only works well with some stuff. Like, maybe they could do your kitchen and like put your dishes in the cabinet or something, although maybe you're particular about where they go. But like, you can't have someone else unload like your room very well. Like, they could do the furniture. But you have to unload, like, your personal possessions because you don't want other people touching them and you want to put them where you want them and so on. Anyway, certain things are awkward to outsource, but you can definitely outsource, like, significant amounts of the moving process. I think there was a shot where they were, like, carrying boxes. Yeah, see? You can outsource that part, at least, where you're carrying the boxes in the door. But they can't because they don't have the money, which is okay, but it's not something to smile about. This is also, it's like, it looks like quite a nice place. It's very near the coast, and their house doesn't appear like particularly small. So it seems like exaggerated for how nice it is, for how poor they are and how just getting started they are.
You learn my secrets and you figure out why I'm guarded.
Like, it's not like nice, but it looks pretty okay and like kind of large for people who can't pay their bills yet. The location seems really good.
It was hard to take, yes, this is what I thought about. Do you remember we were sitting there by the water?
Okay, so yes, this is what I thought about. So when it was hard to take, she thought about this. What this means is, in the past, when things were hard, when they were struggling, she thought about this future vision of this family that she wants. So sort of, she was sustained through bad times by imagining this ideal future that they make romance songs about. And that's dangerous because it's basically like ignoring and putting up with all this bad stuff in the present. That's what it's telling people to do, is just, you know, deal with and accept all this hardship and bad stuff because you have a fantasy about the future that'll make it all worthwhile. And it is better in general to try to make your life good now. Like, there's some extent in some ways that hardships can be okay and you can be like, yeah, I'm planning for the future, but when you have like a really unrealistic fantasy and you're like dead set on a very specific future, they're not telling the story in the most realistic way. Their goal is not to make the story as realistic as possible. And it's bad to like decide this hardship now is okay because they'll have this in the future when you're not actually realistically thinking about the future. You're not using logic to estimate what are the chances of this outcome and what are the chances of that outcome. And, you know, how good is this outcome and how good is that outcome? She's just thinking ahead, not about the present, and in an unrealistic way. The emphasis on the first time, and it's not even fucking sex, it's just putting your arm around her, is very into, like, the first time you have sex matters. Like, the first time you do each sexual escalation is very important to the relationship. Which I think is, that hurts people, that makes people nervous about it, and it makes them, like, freak out, because they're like, well, that didn't go perfect, and we don't get a do-over, because the second time's not so important, it's the first time that counts, and we have to, like, make all the memories perfect the first time. That's bad. But the alternative of, you know, all that stuff doesn't matter, so just party and be slutty is also bad. You have bad pop songs on the one hand and bad pop songs on the other hand. Two different ways to screw up your life. Careful, daughter, you are the best thing. It's better. You saw me so careless, man. Careful, daughter, for the first time. You made a rebel. Where I am. This is like new lyrics. Do you remember all the city lights on the water? You saw me start to believe for the first time. So like they saw pretty lights and then she believed that their relationship would work. Like those should not be connected like that. Like they have, and it's the visuals in the song are the same. Like they have all these pretty visuals. They live in a pretty place and they're associating like the prettiness of the external circumstances with belief that their life will work out well. And the things that make your life work out well are not how much you tingled when he first put his arm around you, or how pretty the lights on the water were when he first put his arm around you, or like on one of your dates. Like those are not the things that actually make a long-term relationship work well. I think they had a fighting scene. I wanted to find that. Oh, that looks like fighting. Pulling her hair out, they're yelling at each other. She's so mad. She like touched him in the chest. Oh, there's lyrics. Oh, okay, I was like almost there, I guess. Okay, so they got married, but now they fight at 2:30 a.m. Everything was slipping right out of her hand. They have like one fight, and it seems like their whole relationship is falling apart because they're viewing the relationship as so tied to like how pretty things are right now. Like, the lights on the water are pretty, the fight is ugly, so now they have ugliness, so it seems like everything's not working. And they're, like, losing their vision. Like, they have a fantasy about the future, and then when one thing goes wrong, it, like, threatens their whole fantasy. And it makes the fights, like, bigger and more severe. Because, like, the whole fantasy in the future is at risk, not just what they have now. A little good in that, because trying to build towards something and underestimate like what they have now. They're like, well, I can just start over with a different person, and they don't realize like how much time they've spent together and how much they've like built up mutual understanding and like ability to communicate effectively with each other and that kind of thing. Like people sometimes underestimate and don't notice and take for granted some of the actual positives in their interactions with people. Why people break up and get back together a lot is like they break up because they see something bad. And then they get back together because they missed something that was good that they didn't like adequately take into account when they broke up. Everything was slipping right out of our hands. Our So they fought. She thought it was going to be over, and she was surprised when he said, "I'll never leave you alone. I'm not dumping you for crying and fighting." There's something screwy about that. Like, she cried. She ran out. The one who initiated leaving. So to say, "I'll never leave you alone," in response to someone, like, leaving, that's kind of like stalker behavior, you know? That's like, "You can't leave, I'm not letting you leave." You can take it in a really bad way. And she's presenting it in a positive way, but it's also showing how much, like, the man is in charge. And she's like, "Well, I was just being a flighty girl who is mercurial and emotional, and then he accepted me and didn't want to leave me, so he said he'll keep me," which was his decision. Like, she's presenting it as his decision whether they stay together or break up. She's like, "Oh, he decided to keep me. I was so happy." But right after, she had signaled that she at least wanted some space. And instead of giving her space, he was, you know, from one perspective, smothering and overly aggressive. But she liked it. And that's, guys are often in a position where they have to sort of guess. Like, the girl gives mixed signals. Because there were certainly positive signals that she likes him and wants a relationship with him. Like, so there are definitely signals both ways. The immediate signals were mostly negative, but, like, there were longer-term signals that were positive. And so what do you do in that situation? Maybe she would prefer space, and maybe she would prefer everything's fine. The long-term matters more than the short-term. It was just a temporary fight. Like, it could go either way. Like, sometimes after a fight, she's like, you know, she wants to be left alone until tomorrow. That's a real attitude. That's reasonable. Someone could want a break for the rest of the day and, you know, "I need to sleep on it and change my mood, and then we'll talk about it later when I'm feeling more myself and rested and calm and it's less recent and all that shit." You know, that could be completely reasonable. He's not giving her that option. Like, she actually ran out crying and he followed, and he was pushy and aggressive and assertive. And, you know, I'm not saying one way or the other is right for the guy's actions. I'm saying the guy's in a tough position because you can get accused of being, like, a bad person for doing either option. Like, you can be accused of being, like, borderline abusive if you're too pushy with women. And it's like, she was crying, she just ran out, stop chasing her, leave her alone, you're being too aggro. But you can also be accused of being, like, too passive and, like, "Don't you care about her? Why didn't you chase her?" if you don't do it. So you can get accused of bad stuff either way. And she doesn't say what she wants. You're supposed to, like, know or guess somehow. Word. Ever explain the careless man's careful daughter, or what way she was rebellious? Like, this fantasy is that she got a house with this guy, they had a few fights, they got married, they had a kid, or multiple kids, I don't know. They were poor at first, then they got better jobs, stuff like that. She's not rebellious. She's not being a rebel. She's living, like, a very traditional life. So it's weird. I don't get the rebellion. Oh, maybe they just got engaged, and then they had the fight, and then they got married, and then they had the baby. I think I had the timeline wrong. Like, yeah, it was just an engagement, and then they fought, but then he wanted to keep her. So it's after they were engaged. That is more of a sign to go after her instead of give her space. But still, even if you're engaged, like, reasonable for her to want, like, a break for the rest of the day, even when you're engaged. And it really could go either way on which one she prefers. Sometimes it's like girls storm out and cry and whatever, and to some extent be an I win card. Like, the guy is supposed to follow her but also give in and say she can have whatever she wants and he'll make it okay for her according to her standards. To some extent it's a negotiating tactic for her to win the argument, which is as bad. It's not logic, it's not figuring out what's best, it's not a common preference, it's not finding something that works for both of them. It's not being on the same team. Kind of attitudes are a problem. Sorry. Pop music has a lot of bad messages. Teaches bad ideas about relationships. A lot of the popular stuff right now is very, like, hedonism and partying. There's not a lot that's redeeming about it. It's just sort of like break the traditional rules, they're constraining, fuck them. It doesn't really have a positive vision of how to have a good life. So that's like extra fucking bad with, and then this is like a bit country and a bit older and not as popular. Like this is 286 million views versus, you know, this one was way more. Like, this is like well known as, like, switched from country to more mainstream stuff in order to have a bigger audience, to be more popular, to do career progress. So this is like the, like, less good for her career that has less broad appeal than the kind of party songs that our pop stars make. I think that's my general understanding. Like, I'm not that familiar with music genres and pop star histories and stuff, but that's my general gist of what happened. Smaller and more wholesome, and it promotes romantic fantasies that are really unrealistic, and they pressure people to not have sex before marriage, or, you know, not be too slutty or something sort of in that ballpark. It varies and it's usually not too specific. But this song actually made a big deal out of the first time he put his arm around her. Clothed, and that's like a major escalation point. So imagine what they think the first time they have sex is. That's like super important. And whether she's a virgin is probably really important and so on. But I mean, she did date other guys, but she didn't necessarily have sex with them. They certainly don't admit that she did. Things have liberalized enough that she could have had sex with other guys. Like, she doesn't have to be a virgin, but they keep hinting things sort of in that direction, that it would be good if she was. It's kind of oppressive, and like, there's a reason there are reactions against them. There's like hedonistic mainstream shit that's in favor of like partying and fun, and like, why give up fun? What the fuck for? Like, what do we need all these restrictions for? They see like all this traditional shit as sort of pointless and unnecessary, and, you know, it's not all good and there are pointless aspects, but on the whole, it is better than nothing. It's better than arbitrary random behavior. Like, this is where civilization came from, with traditional values. Which, by the way, I don't know how much these like romantic fantasies are even that traditional. Like, were the fucking like serf peasants in Europe who had to like live on the farm their whole life, and like, were they being super romantic when they married the person next door? Like, having huge fantasies about it, or did they just think that's life and have a more like practical, realistic view? Romantic fantasies with the like ideal stuff exactly came from, or how old it is, or how widespread it's been at different periods in history. Diamond rings, I've read about like marketers trying to create more demand for them and associating them with weddings. Like, that was not all of history that you could use diamond engagement rings and diamond wedding rings. That is I forgot when it started, but it wasn't the last 500 years, you know, it's less than that. And I think there are other things that some of them are like really old and ongoing and some are not. And they're mixed together and it can be a bit hard to tell which are which. Anyways, if you're going to throw out a bunch of like normal stuff, you better have some like better ideas rather than just rules suck, well, let's be rebels. So I respect like the party songs less because they're like less to do with our culture, and they're not trying to improve on our culture in a substantial way. Like, understand, all right, which parts of our culture are actually important or useful. Marriage thing, it's wrong with it, and I think it's bad that it's viewed as like the only way to live. But have enough trouble doing that they definitely don't know how to do alternatives very well in general. And they're not doing a good job of learning what alternatives will actually work or trying to improve things. They're not doing a very good job of like incremental improvement. Like, okay, here's a specific problem with the marriage stuff and here's a solution. It's just sort of partying is fun, so let's forget about those rules that we don't like. Which is very like whim worshipy, wishful thinking rather than intelligent thinking. These are very popular. These are how people think about life. Like, if people hated these lyrics and thought, well, that's fucking stupid, why would you live a life like that? Then songs would be made differently. whoever you are, you probably believe a fair amount of stuff from the songs, even if you would deny it. You probably do. And most people are not that good in introspection and knowing what they believe. A lot of people are like surprised when they turn into their parents. They're surprised when they have like sides of themselves and they didn't know. And they're like, oh, I didn't know I'd act like that when I had kids. Or, you know, when I was younger, I thought one way, but now that I'm older, I see this other way. And it's like, yeah, that's so predictable. You're just following like the standard life pattern and you didn't realize you had certain values because you were at a different age or a different like life situation where they didn't express themselves as much. And that's completely different than you not being that kind of person. Like there's so many people who are like, oh, I'm a party girl, not a wholesome girl. But then when they turn 30, they're like, oh, I want to have kids. I'm going to be a wholesome girl. And maybe they're less good at it because they've been a party girl. But a lot of people like go more in that direction and change a bit and party less. And realize they would be like that until they actually got to that point in their life. Like they didn't know in advance that that was what they want. There are a ton of people who are like, oh, I don't want kids. And then they, 3 years later, oh, I do want kids. That's not me. You might not know yourself that well. That's really common. So what can you do about these problems? What action can you take? You can think critically about things that you like, that you spend time on. Whatever songs you listen to, like you could read the lyrics and write down in words, what are some bad things about lyrics? What do you actually think is good and what do you actually think is bad? What are your actual opinions? Like write out your opinions and try to think them through and like, do your best to figure out what you think instead of just listening to a bunch and being like, oh, well, it's just a song. You know, take it a bit more seriously and be like, okay, well, I'm listening to these words. I like something about it. And it's possible that you just like the music and not the lyrics, but, you know, actually go through and write down, okay, here's why I think this lyric is bad. If you have reasons, you know, at least that's something. And you'll be trying to understand yourself and think things through. But don't just, like, assume you dislike the lyrics without even thinking about, like, well, what do you dislike about them? What do you think is bad about them? What is your reasoning? If you can't even state your reasoning, then you're probably fooling yourself. Your own analysis. Even make a video if you want. Videos are good. You can talk. Like, if you find talking easier than writing, most of the value is from putting things into words, and using writing instead of talking is, like, a bonus, especially if you're good at it. But it's not, like, that important. But don't just think thoughts in your head and then be like, okay, I know what I mean. Just get it out in actual words. So if you say words out loud, even if you don't record them, that is like most of the benefit of writing them down, is just actually speak them out loud, even if you're alone in a room and you're not recording. But if you want to record, that's even better.